Back in the mid-19th century, jumping off a tall structure was thought to cause death. Not just by the landing, which would certainly kill you, but by the simple action of jumping into the air. The belief was the air was so thin at great heights that you would suffocate before you ever reached the ground. It was the age of industrialization. The skyline of cities were growing at a fevered pace. This fear of dying in the air was a problem. Before sprinklers and fire alarms, the local fire department fought fires with water and ladders. The downside? The ladders were too short to reach the top floors of the new buildings. But the fire department did have nets. People could save themselves from fires by jumping off of buildings into the nets below. Oh, did I mention? People thought they would suffocate before hitting the safety nets. So everyone was scared to jump, even if it meant surviving a fire. Enter Professor Robert Emmett Odlum. Odlum was a swimming instructor at a school he established called the Natatorium in Washington, D.C. He was a showman and a skilled diver. He once jumped 110 feet off a steamship ladder into a river. After the Natatorium failed, Odlum was looking for opportunities to spread his message about swimming and safety. He hit upon the idea of jumping off the newly constructed Brooklyn Bridge. The Brooklyn Bridge was an engineering marvel. It was finished in 1883, nearly 6,000 feet long, with a height of 135 feet over the East River. To be clear, Odlum did not contemplate jumping off the Brooklyn Bridge for fame, but to show the public you could jump off a high structure and not suffocate in the air. This brings us back to the tall buildings popping up in the cities. Odlum hoped his stunt would show that leaping into nets from burning buildings would save lives, that people would not suffocate in the air. On the day of Odlum's jump, the 19th of May, 1885, the police were out in force. They did not want to see Odlum jump, fearing for his life, and to be honest, to stop others from trying the same stunt. Thousands of citizens showed up to watch. A man in a bathing costume appeared on the bridge. The police swarmed the individual. Meanwhile, Odlum approached the railing of the bridge, while the imposter held the attention of the police. He raised one hand above his head and jumped. His outraised hand was used as a rudder to maintain a vertical position. The jump started well, but something happened about 100 feet above the water, causing Odlum to twist. Some thought it was a wind gust, or maybe a miscalculation by Odlum. He hit the water on his side. Water rose high into the air. The force of the landing rendered him unconscious. A friend in a small boat dove in to rescue him. Odlum was pulled into the small boat, briefly regaining consciousness. He asked if he had done well. Those were the last words he ever spoke. The autopsy revealed that Odlum's spleen, liver, and kidneys were ruptured. A deposit of tuberculosis was found at the base of his left lung. Odlum's first, third, and fifth ribs were broken. The cause of death was determined to be a concussion. You might think this was a tragic story without any virtue. But Odlum did not jump from the bridge to gain personal fame. He wanted to prove a point. To let himself be fully understood, the professor is said to have told a Herald reporter a few hours before his jump, "If I should die, I don't want the public to think I had no good object in view. I want the Herald to explain that I have for years illustrated the fact that men do not die while falling through the air. And no matter if men or women were 100 feet high on the roof of a burning building, they would not hesitate to jump into a net if they read that I had jumped 140 feet from the Brooklyn Bridge." Professor Robert Emmett Odlum will be remembered as the first person to jump off the Brooklyn Bridge.